Hi, good evening, everybody. My name's Toby Camps. I'm curator of modern and contemporary art here at the Menil Collection. And it's a great pleasure to welcome you to tonight's presentation by Professor Roberto Tejada entitled Family Resemblances in 1990s Mexico. Before I introduce Professor Tejada, though, I want to just thank my colleague Cindy Pena, who's seated here in the front row. This was her idea, as were the other program for the Fabiola project, and also the next one, which is happening February 17th. It's going to be a musical performance by Red Current, a group of all women musicians headed by our very own Sandy Ewan, who's kind of the great experimental music person here in Houston, among others, but that will promise us to be very great. So I'm big thank you to Cindy for all your hard work on all these programs to accompany the Fabiola project by Francis Alÿs. Roberto Tejada is a poet and visual scholar, currently the Hugh Roy and Lily Krantz Cullen Distinguished Professor of English and Creative Writing at the University of Houston. He's the author of the poetry collections Full Foreground, Exposition Park, and Mirrors for Gold. He's a translator, an editor, an essayist, a photography historian, and a critic, and his multifaceted cultural studies and creative activities have been recognized with numerous fellowships and grants, including awards from the National Endowment for the Arts, the Fulbright Foundation, Creative Capital, the Warhol Foundation, Fundacio Armando Alvarez in Sao Paulo, Brazil, as well as the Sterling and Francine Clark Art Institute. He has lived in Mexico City, formerly from 1987 to 1997, where he worked as an editor at Vuelta magazine, the cultural monthly published by the late Nobel laureate poet Octavio Paz, and as executive editor of Artes de México, a quarterly detailing the pre-conquest to contemporary Mexican art. He also worked there, and he founded the multilingual literary journal Mandorla, New Writing from the Americas. He also co-edited with Kristen Dykstra and Gabriel Bernal Granados a publication featuring innovative writings in its original language, most commonly in English or Spanish, and high-quality translations of existing materials together with visual art and other forms of cultural inquiry. He has taught at the National Autonomous University of Mexico, UNAM, Dartmouth College, the University of California, San Diego, where we first met years ago, the University of Texas, Austin, SMU Meadows School for the Arts, the Naropa University Summer Writing Program, and the Milton Avery Graduate School of Arts at Bard's College. Professor Tejada is committed to conversation, whereby culture and poetics enliven sites of inquiry, regional, transnational, and diasporic. Tejada's research and creative interests involve the language, arts, and image worlds of Latin America, especially Brazil and Mexico, also the U.S.-Mexico borderlands, and other sites of Latino cultural production. Tonight, Professor Tejada will discuss his firsthand experiences during an extremely important and vibrant time in Mexico City, when Francis Alÿs and many other important artists came into their own. Through photographs and personal recollections, he will describe the extraordinary people and places enlivening Mexico City's historic center in the late 20th century. He was both a participant in and observer of the artistic and literary community that put Mexico at the center of the contemporary cultural map in the 1990s. And please join me in welcoming Professor Tejada.
Thank you all for being here tonight, and I want to thank Toby Camps, Tony Martinez, who helped with the audiovisual, and especially to Cindy Pena, who made all the arrangements for this to be possible. So given the unprecedented political environment in which we're living, I thought as I was composing this that this is maybe what follows is something like a parable about intentionality with others. And so I begin with nothing, a mere scrap of paper measuring 4 by 6 inches, its surface yellowed mildly over time. If you look closely, you can see the muted green lines and the red topmost bar of the paper neatly torn from a composition notebook or ledger of the kind sold at local stationery suppliers in Mexico. Dominating the upper left corner of the arrangement's likeliest position is the diamond or chevron support for the celestial globe that features as the centerpiece of the Brazilian flag, with its five-pointed stars meant to evoke the night sky over the nation, with its equatorial band and the motto, Orden y Progreso, order and progress. The lines of the diamond rest not on a field proper to a flag, but on marks depicting a circular surface, maybe a dinner plate, in view of the serrated knife that so rests on an edge as to cast a shadow and provide depth of perspective. Is the diamond a tiny pennant, a paper cocktail napkin? Is the dish rather the oversized lens of a magnifying glass with what appears to be a short handle protruding from the lower curve? The signs further destabilize under the handwritten phrase in the uppermost left corner, the promissory note, I will be back soon. At any rate, in the graphic logic of this drawing, a doodle really, those elements give way to a cascade of objects below rendered in fine point pen. Edgy and agitated markings turned in hairline strokes depict a series of items that include three packs of cigarettes, one soft, the foiled paper neatly torn away to create a convenient dispensing aperture, cigarette protruding. A beer bottle, its contents half consumed, is orbited by a mass-produced square-shaped ashtray with remains of recent smoking, as well as a salt shaker, a sugar dispenser, a small juice glass and straw or stir stick, and a pair of eyeglass frames. Suspended as well, in unspecified space, a few more irregular lines render the notation of a male figure, face slightly obscured by a sizable bird resting on a shoulder. Above, three propeller blades pertaining to a freestanding desk fan seem to emit or make hover in all caps the word boa, Portuguese for good, nice, cool, that strikes a distinct contrast with the inverted phrase along the lower margin, not a good move. The Mexico City-based Belgian artist Francis Alÿs scrawled this composition while our attentions were more or less otherwise applied in conversation around the dining table of my apartment on Calle Durango 127 in the Colonia Roma neighborhood. The year was either 1994 or 1995, but at any rate, the flag motif was a possible allusion to Francis's forthcoming or current exhibition at the Galeria Camargo Villaza in Sao Paulo. Featured prominently in broader conversations were the excitements in Mexico around Brazil's contemporary art world. Further confirming the current internationalization of Latin American art that, by and large, had been consolidated. I had arrived in Mexico in 1987 and had first worked on the editorial board of Vuelta, a monthly magazine of politics and the arts published by the poet Octavio Paz. Then, in 1990, for the quarterly art journal Artes de México. In 1992, on a windfall, I was recommended by Robert Littman, then director of the Centro Cultural Arte Contemporáneo, to serve as his proxy on the judging committee to the award exhibition Echo Art 92 at Rio de Janeiro's Museo de Arte Moderna, in conjunction with Rio Earth Summit, a global conference on ecology. One of the prize winners was the Brazilian painter Daniel Sinise, about whose work I later wrote for the artist's first museum exhibition in Mexico at the Museo de Arte Contemporáneo de Monterrey in 1994. And I featured an image of one of Sinise's large format canvases, O Beijo do Elo Perdido, Oil on Canvas of 91, on the cover of the 1995 issue 4 of Mandorla, Nueva Escritura de las Américas, New Writing of the Americas, the annual multilingual journal of poetics and poetry, translation, and visual arts I founded in 1991. Sinise's canvas depicts what appears to be the calcified crania of two birds joined at the beak, the monumental form, a connection or kiss, telling of a lost link, elo perdido, or abandoned attachment. Two, Francis Alÿs deployed bird forms in the works he submitted to the 1993 group exhibition, Lesa Natura, for which Cuauhtémoc Medina and I co-wrote the catalog essay on works by 14 artists, including that of Francis, as well in an untitled oil on an encaustic on wood of 1998. International connections survive in the ink and paper composition by Alÿs, Mexico, Belgium, Brazil, and US Latinidad. It is tenuous supporting evidence for so much else that evanesces into the past, the reverse side to an image of the world before the emergence of high-speed digital delivery and storage systems, an exponentially expandable archive that endures, however more fragile than this tiny ledger tear sheet. I begin with a private notation, small memento from the past, parable scrap of history to contain the elements of memory, itself a kind of doodling, free associative, and produced out of conversations with pen and paper at hand. I want contrary things, what anthropologist Kathleen Stewart calls ordinary affect, but as well a public narrative about innovative artists and alternative spaces when it was still a society of alternate belonging in the late 20th century around Mexico City's historic center. Private notation and public narrative get blurred in this photograph made around the year Francis Alÿs left on my table the little remnant of a dialogue. In the picture, together with Alÿs, whose elongated physique on the right is so crucial to his art of public interaction, are the historian Dana Levine and the art critic and curator Cuauhtémoc Medina, with me below completing the quartet. The occasion was one of any number of pretexts for sociability and carousal at the apartment home of U.S. artist Thomas Glassford on Calle Licenciado Verdad in the historic urban center of Mexico City. Levine, Medina, and I, as well as philosopher Ernesto Priani and psychoanalyst Manuel Hernandez, had been meeting from time to time as part of a quasi-secret society reading group called La Dalia Negra, the Black Dahlia. Our name derived from the infamous LA crime case, even as our bibliography included both the high and low. Michel Foucault's I, Pierre Rivière, having slaughtered my mother, my sister, my brother, a case of parricide in the 19th century. Thomas De Quincey's essay on murder, considered as one of the fine arts. And true crime pulp fiction, like Thomas Harris's Red Dragon of Hannibal Lecter fame. By 1993, I had published a handful of art reviews in magazines and Sunday supplements, and Cuauhtémoc invited me to co-author the catalog essay for an exhibition that joined avant-garde art to the cause of ecology at the Museo de Arte Moderno, as I mentioned, Lesa Natura, Reflexiones sobre Ecología, Marred Nature, Reflections about Ecology. Conceived by poet Homero Arizpe and the young artist collective known as La Quiñonera, curated by Carlos Ashida and Patrick Charpanel, supported by several official institutions and various independent, if not oppositional, organizations in the field of ecology in Mexico, and comprised of artists whose viewpoints and techniques were extremely, extremely varied, the exhibition, hardly unilateral or conclusive, included work by artists Francis Alÿs, Thomas Glassford, Silvia Gruner, Gabriel Orozco, La Quiñonera, and Pablo Vargas Lugo, among others. These artists were able to insinuate visual grammars still unfamiliar to institutional settings in Mexico, an attempt to fracture what many perceived as the airtight vessel through which Mexican art was officially legitimated. In the photograph with Francis, Cuauhtémoc dons a cartridge belt that is an early Gord piece by Thomas Glassford. It's actually called An Invitation to Portage. A borderland native of Laredo, Texas, Glassford had arrived in Mexico in 1990, along with Texas Latino artists Ethel Shipton and Alejandro Diaz. The cartridge belt was an allusion to those worn by insurgents in Mexico's revolutionary period and its depictions in post-revolutionary visual culture. Contemporary parallels to that historic moment were inevitable and more than casual, in so much as they lent substance to the high-spiritedness, and murals like those by José Clemente Orozco were but a few blocks away from Calle Licenciado Verdad at the former National Preparatory School, now the Museo de San Ildefonso. Glassford's early sculptural works opposed elements and combinations that were sensuous but unsettling. Material clarity, gourds or guajes, steel, leather, vinyl, and rubber, gave way to sometimes violent pleasures in viewing constituent parts and tactile surfaces subjected to perverse combinations of reason. Glassford's visual grammar addressed the indeterminacy of matter, the desire rehearsed in acts of embodiment, and the ambivalence prompted by the sexualized gaze. By contrast, in other works, like his Endless Column of 1994, he collapsed art historical references to Brancusi with the social use of materials related to the lower body, American standard bathroom ceramic in the shape of gourds. In his 1992 installation entitled Arteria, Artery, at Curare Espacio Critico para las Artes, Glassford dissected the exhibition space into two discontinuous horizon lines, minimalist sequences of soft blue and deep red, so deflecting the respective hues onto the white walls of each gallery as to suggest an interconnected circulatory system. Rectangles of red enamel plates on steel rods contrasted with a blue row composed of wood blocks over which the artist had affixed a tile. The materials and color suspended the unity in a sort of optical congealing. For the blue horizon, Glassford had used commercial bathroom tiles whose design was a trompe l'oeil of water drops and splashes as though beaded over the actual ceramic. The contrast activated an analogy between hydrophobicity, the absence of attraction or adhesion of water molecules to a surface, and corporeal anxieties about blood, saliva, and semen. The body and its fluids were charged with particular significance during the years in which cases of HIV and AIDS and the epidemic had increased exponentially in Mexico. Transposing design elements from class-specific social spaces, gymnasium, public bath, corporate office, or domestic interior, Glassford collapsed real-world settings at once microscopic, corporeal, clinical, and systemic, and for which the gallery walls of Curare served as a placeholder. Curare, a space for creative research, was founded in the summer of 1991 by a group of art historians and cultural theorists, largely led by the late Olivier de Broaz. And it was a training ground for an eclectic circle of art writers and curators who were seeking new methodologies and networks of intellectual exchange. 2 years after Glassford's Arteria, Francis exhibited at Curare what would become the ongoing and proliferating Fabiola project. A composite image of three snapshots shows at a desk Cuauhtémoc Medina typing on the keyboard of an Apple Macintosh Classic, and Olivier de Broaz nearly reclining on a couch in the office gallery of Curare in Mexico City's Colonia Roma. The first Fabiolas assembled by Francis Alÿs can be seen lining the walls. For an aerial view of the actors, objects, and circumstances that gave way to the early downtown art formations in Mexico City from about 1987 to 1992, there really is no better narrative than the one related by Olivier de Broaz in his essay, Entry and Exit, Internationalization of Mexican Art, featured in the catalog to the 2007 exhibition, The Age of Discrepancies, Art and Visual Culture in Mexico, 1968 to 1997, which he curated together with Cuauhtémoc Medina and many of the researchers from Curare a year before his premature death. De Broaz was himself a foreigner, born in Israel, educated in France, And in that essay, he reviews the constellation of forces that led to an international Mexican underground, he calls it. Set against the backdrop of rapid industrialization, increased neoliberal policies, and the deep-seated cultural and political apparatus of the Carlos de Salinas administration, there emerged at the margins a set of new cultural contests, one of which involved the arrival of foreign agents. Within a brief time frame, a confluence occurred. More than 30 Cuban artists managed to obtain letters of invitation to depart from the island for Mexico. Juan Francisco Elso, José Bedia, Quisque Enriquez, and Consuelo Castañeda, among them. There are many others. A band of British art school contrarians and associates found their way from Thatcher's England to the chaos of Mexico City's Federal District. Unconnected paths, but each passing through at distinct moments were slightly more senior figures like Jimmy Durham and Michael Tracy, to whom Houstonians are quite familiar. De Braz's chronicles the appearance and interaction of these foreigners with Mexican artists like Gabriel Orozco and others who had spent time abroad, including Sylvia Gruner, Maria Guerra, and the ubiquitous polymath Guillermo Santa Marina. He relates the August 1986 opening of the adventurous Galería Arte Contemporáneo run by Benjamin Díaz, as well as improvised locations of display like Salón de Aztecas, which Aldo Flores managed out of his family's furniture shop, and La Quiñonera, otherwise known as the home of Néstor and Héctor Quiñones. It would be difficult to overestimate the importance of rentable real estate in the rough-hewn apartment buildings of Mexico City's historic downtown, many of them early modern constructions, or vecindades, nestled among the colonial buildings and pre-conquest ruins that comprise the urban grid, with its abundant evidence of previous political regimes and revolution-era murals, together with the appeal of the populous avenues and overcrowded streets. The constant interchange of affordable housing from one artist to the other led to a cluster of living situations on the Calle Licenciado Verdad and the nearby Plaza Santa Catarina. Lorna Scott Fox, a British writer, cultural journalist, and translator, had rented an apartment on the upper floor of the building on Licenciado Verdad, and in a nearby apartment lived the British photographer Ian Dryden, who recorded scenes from the social life of the moment, including this portrait of Lorna. Writers emerging onto the scene supported artist friends by writing copy for makeshift catalogs, articles for press, reviews, or exhibitions, labor often remunerated with a gift of an artwork, or by purchasing directly from the artist, or commissioning a piece destined for home display. Not long after she had moved from her downtown apartment on Licenciado Verdad to a vecindario in the Colonia Roma on Calle San Luis Potosí 27, Lorna Scott Fox acquired a portable sculpture by Francis Alÿs. It's one of his earliest works, I should add. The untitled work provides a glimpse into the modesty of materials, the clarity of design and execution, and the poetics of the everyday that defined the work of Alÿs at the time and to this day. Francis painted a set of 40 linoleum rectangles on both sides so as to resemble a deck of playing cards for an unspecified game. The back of each card is rendered with deliberate marks as in a paint-by-numbers pattern, depicting a bouquet of sundry flowers in light pink, yellow, and aqua greens. The floral design over a chalk blue background with cloud formations suggests a kind of home style arts and craft wallpaper. The front of each card features a central symbol, tea kettle on a stove burner, house at a railroad crossing, a pack of smokes, an ashtray, and a smoldering cigarette. In relation to the suit of cup goblets on the upper right and lower left hand corners are the letters spelling out a series of comparable terms in English and Spanish. Límites, paciencia, maybe, maybe not, staying, leaving. The bilingual references to understanding and endurance on the borderline between decision and fate activate a system of meanings about the incidence of transit and the instability of belonging. An archival snapshot shows the artist installing the work in Scott Fox's apartment home on the top shelf of a cluttered bookcase beside another shelving unit that blurs the division between the living room and the kitchen space with its blue and white speckled enamelware for cooking and a tequila shot glass nearby. Together with the tile floor that served as a background for one of these documentation photographs, these elements are evidence of how interior domestic living inflected in the materials, style, and treatment of works by artists like Francis Alÿs. In these works, diminutive gestures are prone to have monumental consequences of staying or leaving, freestanding but as unstable as a castle of cards. I think of Lorna having paused at this work from time to time with its image lessons in the day-to-day house, tea kettle, cigarette, as being encounters randomly dealt, but also as occasions that contain, despite all evidence to the contrary, the ability to transfigure. Early works by British artist Melanie Smith also turned, in form and subject matter, to the question of home, habitat, architecture, and indoor design. Smith had already taken over an apartment on the Plaza Santa Catarina left by artist couple Sylvia Gruner from Mexico and Gustavo Perez Monzon from Cuba, who had moved to Licenciado Verdad around 1989. Therefore, in works from 1990 to 1991, Melanie salvaged materials from the debris of buildings undergoing restoration or by other means akin to urban archaeology. In one untitled work, full disclosure, I own this piece, the artist assembled wood components from an interior cornice molding or some other decorative element from an abandoned interior. Re-enchanted residues bespeaking a formerly more sumptuous past. The artist covered the wood in gesso and then stained the assembly in dark brown pigment. From the lower base and right side of the hollow volume protrudes a combination of elements, a rose-papered pegboard construction in the shape of a heart, and the pink tuft of a slightly weathered but still ostentatious tassel. The rose-patterned paper doubles back to Francis Alÿs's House of Cards, and together, Francis and Melanie were a couple and shared the same apartment home. The unrelated works speak of that past and its commitments to the shared energies and experience of a life when it involves the crafting of value, if even for a circle of friends. A household art in its twin sense, these works are talismans of affect and tributes to the labor of placemaking, an art whose form and content harmonize when displayed in the rented home or rented space. These works are so tied to the conditions of their manufacture and display as to be indivisible from that intimacy. The work of Alÿs and Smith connected more distinctly now from the residential perspective, as it did with that of other artists, foreigners, and nationals alike, through collecting practices, very often in a kind of city gleaning. For example, from 1990 to 1992, Alÿs undertook a series of studies, maps, notes, and actions entitled The Collector, a form of street theater documented in collaboration with Felipe Sanabria. The artist paid tribute to Mexico's working class, and to vernacular genius in the form of its bricolage, the inventiveness obliged by making do. Holding a leash that dragged a magnet sculpture with rubber wheels, in the shape of a makeshift toy, Alÿs walked the downtown streets of Mexico City, day or night, inhabiting a persona that was equal parts actual and fictional. He wrote, "For an indeterminate period of time, the magnetized collector takes a daily walk through the streets and gradually builds up a coat made of any metallic residue lying in its path. This process goes on until the collector is completely smothered by its trophies." Similarly, from 1994 to 1996, British artist Melanie Smith turned to sites of exchange on the streets of downtown Mexico City and elsewhere in a collecting practice restricted to the color orange. The artist scoured through a profusion of mass-produced synthetic objects sold in a casual marketplace composed of street vendors and local retailers. The artist bought these items en masse and assembled the resulting accruals into an ultramix of wall sculptures and photographs, into such environments as insinuated by the title Orange Lush. Smith upended any compulsory cause and effect between modes of production and the activities of consumption, between social contract and dislocated economies, or between sensual appeal and purchasing potential. Purchasing potential was at stake for these artists, and not only for everyday means to bankroll the bohemian free time necessary to enable practice. Olivier de Braz and Cuauhtémoc Medina, in their catalog to the Age of Discrepancies, recall, quote, after she arrived in Mexico, Melanie Smith's first studio was located in an old building on the Plaza Santa Catarina. On weekends, she and Francis Alÿs ran an informal restaurant serving brunch. Designed to help make ends meet, it also provided space for informal exhibitions and exchange of information. Their multinational and polyglot circle was defined by immediate impressions and direct experience. Artists and visitors wandering through the heart of the capital, gazing over colonial church domes and Aztec ruins from rooftop patios, using their imagination to come and go anywhere, end quote. Even as these artists and writers had been putting attention to work in the public spaces of Mexico City, it came as well with the ambivalence of curiosity, whose pleasures could never entirely camouflage anxieties about the public turmoil brewing beyond the refuge of this bohemian expatriate community. After 1988, artists and writers in Mexico began to affront the political economy, the predicament of urban overdevelopment, and the effects of industrialization on the environment. A complex process of transformation took place in Mexico, chiefly associated with the presidency, as I've mentioned, of Carlos Salinas de Gortari and his immediate successor. Inasmuch as the former's executive legitimacy was negligible, given the overwhelming evidence of fraudulent elections that led his investiture, a fact never lost on public feeling, Salinas launched a campaign of so-called moral renovation in government to obliterate corruption. It began with the shocking early-term incarceration of shady government and labor officials, Laquina, Pesqueira. The print media had experienced a relaxing of the government's monopoly on newsprint, which had been used to punish newspapers that were overly critical. There were heightened political expectations that, despite the negative effects and privatization and free trade, NAFTA, there appeared to be the promise of a more or less transparent democratic electoral process. Prevalent in the foreground to all this and on the media was the challenge as well to the Mexican state led by the Zapatista movement in Chiapas. And then, on March 23, 1994, Luis Donaldo Colosio, presidential candidate of the Institutional Revolutionary Party, or PRI, and de facto successor to President Carlos Salinas de Gortari, was shot and mortally wounded during a campaign rally in Tijuana. The political crime and the ensuing crises were felt in particular urgent ways in Mexico, insofar as political and symbolic investment in Mexico's democratic transition had been attached to the person of Colosio. It was commonplace to speak of conspiracy hand in hand with the actual or symbolic breakdown of authority, and public feeling was raw with language and images where evidence was lacking. And it transmogrified into a sequence of accounts that confirmed or refuted one another. Colosio's assassination appeared to forebode inevitability, and it produced apprehension in Mexico about potential widespread violence. A New York Times article later reported that, quote, during the remainder of Mr. Salinas' administration, which ended on November 30th, 1994, his government was unable to convince the public that it had solved the murder, even though a lone shooter was arrested at the scene and had been convicted and sentenced. When the Attorney General of Ernesto Zedillo's successive administration reopened the case, he promptly arrested, quote, a second suspect and announced that there had been a conspiracy to kill Colosio that might be connected to Mr. Salinas' own government. A few years later, investigators pursuing the Colosio case questioned Mr. Salinas in his exile in Dublin. Although no charges were ever brought or proof given that there had been a conspiracy, let alone one attached to Mr. Salinas, many Mexicans still believe he was in some way involved in Mr. Colosio's death. Meanwhile, Raul Salinas, the president's brother, waited out his sentence in a Mexico City jail on charges that he had engineered another assassination of 1994, that of José Francisco Ruiz Massieu, Secretary General of the Institutional Revolutionary Party. The American poet Susan Briante, who also lived in Mexico during those years, recalls, quote, "The passage of NAFTA and subsequent peso crisis were foundations to an understanding of the brutality of global capitalism. When you experience a national currency devaluation as we did in Mexico in 1994, you begin to understand the fragility of system," end quote. As for those of us in La Dalia Negra, the Black Dahlia, we had more or less disbanded, but how could we not but have felt the uncanny in our midst, looking back at our research into the literature of crime and criminality? Recalling the vulnerable ties that bind the political to the personal around that particular historic juncture in his memoir essay, Homeland Insecurity, Thomas Glassford, pictured on the left, underscores the traditional structures of kinship and economy in contemporary Mexico, with its vestiges of colonial protocol and patronage systems. He writes, "Family life, social bonding through environment, education, and cliques are very prevalent. On any given Sunday afternoon, one is expected to be having lunch and spending time with one's family. Inevitably, this same rigor led many individuals living in Mexico to form their own family units, including us foreigners living in Mexico City in the beginning of the 1990s. A group of artists, writers, and historians arriving in Mexico from different locations chose to live in the city center, the historical, then downtrodden and rough, but invigorating heart of the centro. As for the nuclear family, Glassford notes that it was, quote, difficult to arrange renting contracts in Mexico without one, that is a family. All contracts must be signed by a fiador, a resident cosigner, or a property owner to guarantee that rent will be paid and rental property preserved. Obviously, some of us found this favor difficult to ask, and arranging to rent out a floor in a building as an artist was not exactly the ideal for some proprietors, much less being a foreigner. Consequently, he continues, there were a couple of buildings in particular in the centro, one being on the side street off the Zócalo, Licenciado Verdad, the other a few blocks further north on the Plaza Santa Catarina, where inevitably we found ourselves primarily ensconced after other artists had arranged previous relationships with the owners and established what in one case in particular, Señora Susana, was an extension of the family as well. While we would often share meals together, drink together, and live in each other's spaces, we also began to organize exhibitions and projects, being that we hadn't found many other alternatives to show our work. Through this community of extranjeros in El Centro, we began to have some influence within the cultural, social infrastructure of the city, sharing our homes, studios through parties, exhibitions, meals, and other disorganized events. When we began to show our work along with other Mexican artists in more formal spaces and galleries, we also became more entrenched as a separate movement due to our style of work and method, but primarily as a family unit," end quote. Foreignness, friendship, and foreboding. Family refashioned in flights from everyday predicament into the sociability of art and into the art of sociability. The disintegrating systems that led to the crises of 1994 had included the collapse of the national economy, corruption and brutality of the state, the breakdown of authority, and with it, challenges to a narrow view of Mexican citizenship. Even as only intimations of this would have been foreseen or contained in so modest a sculpture as A Castle of Cards, its meanings accrue over time in the hidden historical view. Whether the cozy metaphor of a house of cards alluded generally to futures that are vulnerable to chance and the elements, prone to unpredictability and collapse, Francis Alÿs nonetheless made and installed this work in the years that were leading to such critical points in the political and daily life of Mexican society. the modular object allowed for enactments of the precariousness. It made tangible collapse and disintegration while serving importantly as an object for household exhibit meant to recall that work and play can unite to reinforce the networks of social relation. That assuming work telescopes from a snapshot developed in the past into the actual space of the present and the walls that surround us in the Byzantine chapel. Around the time he made the untitled House of Cards, Francis Alÿs had already set into motion collecting practices that have now led to more than 450 reproductions amassed since 1992. An 1885 painting by French academic artist Jean-Jacques Henner. The Fabiola project is the result of a temporal process, an evolving collection instigated by the act of sifting and sorting through the flea markets, first by Alÿs himself, then also by an expanding network of friends and fellow artists who have served as accomplices, stakeholders, and surrogate researchers in the project. From the surplus of reproductions that point to a prototype, the symbolic adhesives of idea and design provide coherence to each unique object whose maker or makers remain largely unidentified. The system so unleashes a concentric relationship between collector and collection as to make the lost original loom large, in direct proportion to the increase of objects that comprise the impossible task of totality. The assembly cannot be neutral in that it represents the transposed, the foreign, the expatriated, the lost, and the exiled. The efforts and energies that drive the system seek a still point over time and geography, a home for the infinite set. Collections are haunted by the infinite set, to which assembly aspires impossibly. They strive for cohesion of the purposive and non-purposive, and to serve as a charm for times of uncertainty. If historic truth remains obscured, always in the past, once a living unity, ever at a distance from lived experience, the demand for it induces a fever Alÿs describes in another context as being that which records the way dreaming might have a role in the possibility of rethinking our conviviality. Such reverie beckons us as well to reimagine cultural transmission as a kind of intentional ancestry. Feminist philosopher Elizabeth Gross reminds us that descent, family, is not only a genetic concept, but rather a durational one. She writes, a way of accumulating the past in the present, that is, to inherit something from a family is to live something of its past in my present. It is what I inherit as my living being or body. The proliferative effects of Fabiola invite us to discern the family resemblances between the unrecorded exchange and the public document. Between the intimacy that tells of a lost link or abandoned attachment and that which is made embodied, entrusted, bequeathed, handed on, and passed on as an endowment. The art historian Georges Didier Huberman speaks of this certain inheritance when he suggests, before an image, finally, we have to humbly recognize this fact, that it will probably outlive us, that before it, we are the fragile element, the transient element, for it possesses more memory and more future than the being who contemplates it. I'm prompted by the generosity of friends and fellow artists who provided photographs and recollections to serve as shareable words and images tonight, yet another transmission. Prompted by a will for such former and future selves to survive as family resemblances on the face of every Fabiola, with energies and attitudes that first embolden with a purpose to transform as much in art and writing as in sociability and friendship, an artery, a rose paper heart, a tassel, a castle of cards, a tea kettle, a pack of smokes, a tiny pennant, a promissory note, and all these Fabiolas. They join tonight in a monument to the little genealogies of conviviality and life, the aspirations of art and contingent community, an elegy to all the interactions now lost to the public record, staying, leaving, limites, paciencia, maybe, maybe not. Thank you. So I think there might be time for questions, is that right?
And I have a mic here, if anybody.
Cuauhtemoc Medina, who was your colleague and contemporary there, spoke a lot about how, maybe this was even a few years before you arrived in Mexico City, but how he felt that at the university, the crisis happened. There was the earthquake, the devaluation, and that the students really stepped in and suddenly found that they could play a leading role in the society. Did you see that in action?
I did, because when I arrived in 87, Cuauhtémoc was still a militant in the student movement at CEU, in the Ciudad Universitaria. And I think that's, I would say, in the aerial view of the history, I think those elements are certainly important, and certainly the earthquake of 85 has been remarked as an important element in the unifying of civic society, certainly the ways in which organizations and the possibility of new redirections of social energies took place at the university. And those are certainly part of the larger field, and I think by the time that what we get to the changing economy, which takes place when Salinas enters in 88 with the opening up of free trade and especially with the NAFTA agreement, the beginning of the maquiladoras on the border with the United States, the sort of opening up Mexico to foreign investment, which is a rhyme, an economic rhyme with the opening up to foreign cultural producers. I think all these come together to sort of form the larger, sort of more panoramic view of this kind of history. I think more and more I'm interested in little micro histories of what happens when you look at something that would go absolutely forgotten by the historical record and see if that kind of activates something just as momentous or monumental, but that would otherwise be lost. So those larger, and I do recommend, I mean, one of the excitements about this particular moment is that there are very powerful narratives that describe that aerial view, many of them associated with exhibitions, including some of the ones I mentioned, the Age of Discrepancies, the PS1 show, Mexico City, Strange Currencies that was in Philadelphia, the Pacific Standard Time, second edition that will be taking place in Los Angeles will include many exhibitions, one in particular called Below the Underground, curated by Irene Satsos at the Armory Center in Pasadena. So as the larger narrative breaks into smaller narratives, these little stories, these little histories begin to give us sort of the thickness of it as well. And the thickness of relation, I think, is something that's of great interest to me.
Hi, I wanted to ask if you could speak a little bit about the politics of Mexico City at that time and how there was kind of a rise or activism among artists making work in the street, you know, and doing a lot of, I guess, what we would now call social practice.
But right.
At that time, it was just sort of what you did if you were an artist, and how that coincided with Francis kind of doing the magnet collector piece and the paint, poured paint pieces and the ice, the melting ice block, I'm not remembering the name offhand. And, you know, just that sort of connection. Yes. Would be interesting to
and
hear.
And Francis's titles always have titles like, sometimes to do something political is to do something poetic, or sometimes something to do something poetic is to do something political. It's always interesting, and I think it's historically valid to look at the past through the lens of the present. And I think if we look back at many of these practices, they do reveal the drive behind artist social practice. So in interviewing Melanie Smith recently, she's receives emails and inquiries often about Mel's Cafe, which can be seen as a kind of artist social practice, right? Settings of reciprocity, settings of exchange and so forth. But I think you're referring to more like the taking of the Edificio Balmori, which was one of these sort of, there were many street theater performances at the taking of the streets. Many of them were not documented. So this exhibition that's coming up actually below the underground tries to document some of those, because it really was, you had to be there. If you missed it, you wouldn't have seen it but for in documentation. But something like the taking of the Balmori was a kind of occupy movement insofar as artists from different stripes and different aesthetics took over a building, a Belle Epoque building on one of the avenues in the Colonia Roma, and which was being threatened to be condemned and razed and destroyed. And Aldo Flores, who is an artist and had founded a small space that I mentioned called Salón de las Aztecas, had rallied to have artists paint on the outside of the building, and it became both a kind of festivity of the occupying it until the authorities would come by and painted it over. But it lasted a weekend, and this was a place also, again, of sociability and taking art into the streets. Someone like Eugenia Vargas, who was an artist who I was close to, also worked in performance that was out in the streets, but then also brought that practice into her studio. So I think that there are these, I mean, I think this idea of collecting does come from this, just the fact that it was a moment in which that which had often been overlooked, which was vernacular popular imagination, was now being valued in a particular way, both by locals and foreigners alike, and that this was seen as something that was not the narrative of the great national storylines, right? That were heroic storylines, right? That somehow this was an identification with the working class and its artistic genius. In a way, Carlos Monsiváis has a great, there's a very good interview, perhaps one of the last interviews with the great Mexican intellectual Carlos Monsiváis, where he's interviewed in the center itself, on a park bench in the city center, and he's asked about Francis Alÿs' work and about other things, and he may have said one of the great, probably, insights about Mexico City's downtown, which is, he says that something like, everything's there. Even visuality, if we understand visuality as the reconciliation of extremes. And this is what I think was the appeal of the streets in Mexico City, was precisely those extremes of extreme density of population, extreme differences in terms of class sectors, in terms of racial dynamics, in terms of historical levels, that is, you would see remnants of the pre-conquest ruins, you would see levels of the colonial past, that of the revolutionary moment, and these were all sort of part of the city was this kind of historic text and palimpsest, which I think artists were very keen to unpack, but not in a way that spoke to the great myths of history, but that the everyday, that everyday living and that everyday life is as heroic and as valuable as those larger myths.
Hola, Roberto. I wanted to ask you if you could elaborate on how the earthquake from 1985 influenced also in this group and also in the production of the artwork in this group that you were a part of, and also how that affected the living conditions in the historic center of Mexico City, because I think it's very important to notice the relationship between the living conditions and the architecture in that part of the city, and how do you think about the space in which the artwork is produced?
Yeah. So there was a lot I could answer there. So I'll begin with that I arrived a year after the Mexico City earthquake. So I didn't get to experience firsthand the kind of fabric of emergency, but also of organization and collectivity that it did inspire. There are many books that have been written about this. But I can tell you that even after a year, not surprisingly, that the fact of the earthquake permeated every conversation at some level. Why? Because when you transited through Mexico City, someone would say, oh, there was a building there. It had now become a park. You would see it, and I think what you're really asking is about the material built environment. So even in a place like Mexico City's downtown, where the colonial buildings were the more architecturally sound buildings, that is, seismically sound buildings, most of them were intact, but many of them did suffer from the earthquake, and they were still in shambles, they were still in ruins. So you did see a city that had markings. So for example, Parque Hundido in the Colonia del Valle was the site of a former housing unit, a series of apartment buildings. And knowing that is something that provides a kind of historical text to the city itself. Insofar, and many novels take place there. I don't think it's a coincidence that Roberto Bolaño in The Savage Detectives, the great novel, and in another version of a talk like this, I would use Roberto Bolaño's phenomenal novel as a kind of key into Mexico City in the 1990s and the kind of kaleidoscopic ways in which we can think about it. But in that very important scene in Bolaño's text where the protagonist meets Octavio Paz, the real character, in this particular park, right? Because I think it has the city after the earthquake gave the built environment a kind of markings of a very recent past that had significantly changed social relations, even for those of us who had not experienced it firsthand.
I'm trying to phrase this question, but I'm wondering, in hindsight, what do you and the other artists of your milieu think about that time, and considering the fact that the political environment didn't really bend towards the progressive, and that the fact that the global art market forces have kind of dominated the art scene in Mexico City. So what do y'all think about that time, knowing all of this other sort of change didn't exactly go in the direction that some people would have preferred?
Well, I mean, it's a very interesting question, but it's a complex one because we're looking at it with hindsight. But I would say that much of the work that was intrepid was certainly a critique on some level of the status quo. But on the other hand, and I think Cuauhtémoc Medina really addresses this point very importantly, it was also a way of positioning oneself in terms of what might be called an aesthetic avant-garde, and in terms of a global art world, which means dealing with market forces on some level, right? That is, both understanding that there were curators and cultural protagonists that were coming to Mexico, and that for someone, a young artist, to somehow have a greater field of influence in terms of his or her critique would be to interact with that global art market. And so the way he describes it is in this very evocative phrase of mutual abuse, that is, both the art world and the market forces were abusing artists insofar as they were using them for its purposes, but artists themselves were also using the art market for their purposes, right? In terms of the politics of the moment, I mean, again, no one can have foreseen the ways that it began to shift. And then, of course, to be more specific, one would have to then look at the ways in which in the 90s it moves from the hegemony of the pre-party of the Partido Revolucionario Institucional to the so-called alternancia, the alternative of having another party, in this case the PAN, having entered, and those seeing that, the expectations of that shift and that opening, the so-called opening of democratic opening, be disillusioned, lead to disillusionment as well, right? While at the same time, the relationship with the United States is getting even more complicated insofar as, especially if you look at the border region, it's when the first, by the mid to late 1990s, we were discovering the feminicide that was taking place on the US-Mexico border associated with the maquiladora economy as well. So it's a messy history that can only be, I think, addressed in these sort of clusters of units of intensity, right, that somehow putting them together in some kind of constellation.
I was wondering if you could talk about your social circle's relationship to what was happening back in the United States. This, of course, was the moment of the culture wars, and I'm wondering what was that kind of transmission of conversation, intellectual influences, and maybe shared aesthetics and battle plans, if you will.
I mean, that's a great question, because I think there were similar kinds of culture wars taking place, and of course, I had access to going back and forth to the United States, and I would follow, and many would follow, the culture wars that were taking place in the US, especially around certain kinds of image making, the famous cases of Mapplethorpe and Andres Serrano being the most visible. And I think that they became, those were debates that certainly were taken up by the Mexican intelligentsia insofar as they were also pushing those contents, those subject matters that were aimed at opening up civil society to be more inclusive. And so you see, for example, debates about sexuality, debates about the renewed debate about the remainders of a colonial sort of overlay that affects race relations in Mexico being discussed. You would see the work of women artists and feminist artists referring to those culture contests in the States. And then very specifically, there were moments in which many of those cultural critics came to Mexico to give talks through Curare, for example, right? Through this space of this espacio crítico de las artes, a critical space for art, because there was an interest in having that kind of conversation take place in Mexico as well, which was also a kind of internationalization, which was to address those issues and those questions in Mexico was to be as, to be contemporary with the debates that were taking place elsewhere. So there was the FITAC, which was an art fair and sort of panel of round tables around art theory that took place in Guadalajara, and you know, art historians and art theorists who were involved in some of those debates. I'm thinking right now of the provocative artist Daniel Martinez, for example, came down and spoke about his inclusion in the Whitney Biennial, for example, right? That important Whitney Biennial was very much part of the conversations that were taking place. So, I mean, I think that's an interesting, that's exactly the kind of entry point that I love, which is just to do a comparative, take one line of kind of intellectual conversation, the culture wars, as they were called in the United States, and see how they played out in Mexico. And I think you could do a very interesting diagram because there were very important, I mean, I'm thinking of Debate Feminista, which is a long-standing feminist publication that was, you know, translating into Spanish theoreticians like Irigaray and De Loretis and so forth. So there was, even though many in the cultural elite spoke and read both French and English, there was a need to disseminate those ideas. And many artists, often artist clusters, were prone to be the translators of those kinds of texts. So also in Themistocles 44, which was a group that is around the same time as those I'm shown, many of them had been trained in art schools in the United States, came back, and then translated many of those articles or essays that were important to their own training and methodology, and had them translated into Spanish in very makeshift publications. I'm thinking of Casper was one, and Alegría, that Pablo Vargas Lugo. These were zines, basically, right, that circulated hand to hand, and that became a kind of glue for a larger sense of belonging to a kind of excitement, an intellectual excitement. Do you want a microphone, just in case? For the record. For the historic record, then.
Of course. So thank you so much. It was really great to hear mentioned, not just the, especially in the beginning of your talk, not just the group of, let's say, the artists that have had so much visibility here recently, right, as Francis Alÿs, Melanie Smith, who's on view right now, just next door to us, and so on, but also Cuban artists who left Cuba after the collapse of Soviet Union. And I was hoping that some of them would come up in this kind of international milieu that you were kind of drawing. So I'm curious why they did not, and maybe what were kind of convergences of, or and divergences happening between different groups that contributed to that fact.
So I would have been happy to talk another 40 minutes about the Cuban artists who lived, as is often remarked, ironically, on the Calle Cuba in Mexico City. So the issue right before issue number 4 of Mandorla that had the Daniel Sinise had an image of Consuelo Castañeda. And to go back to Natalie's question and to tie them together, it was really remarkable the sophistication of training that the Cuban artists came with to Mexico, training in terms of technical training, but training in terms of intellectual rigor and the kinds of readings that they were able to access through underground forms of circulation that involved the kind of critical inquiry of the last 20 years that had to do with contemporary art. So that story, which I would love to tell, would also involve the kinds of intimacies, because many of those, the insertion took quite took a longer time. That is, many of them eventually received, got gallery representation. But you can imagine that coming from a society in which there were no commercial galleries, that transition represented certain challenges as well. While at the same time, many of them were being represented in museum exhibitions. And as you can imagine, that there were also, as Thomas Glassford mentions, a kind of emboldening of different aspects of these different groups insofar as they represented different kinds of training and methodologies and national traditions and legacies. And these were not always translatable or transmissible in the same kind of ways. So some of those conversations were often difficult conversations. What I mean by that is simply that in a society, I mean, you have to imagine that in the course of just like 2 or 3 years, this influx of outside vibrancy. So it's also a parable, if I can go back to that. It's a parable about the values of an open society. And I have to say that that is one of the great generosities of Mexico, is that it's very open to the outside view. There's that great phrase by John Dewey, right? Knowledge is looking from the outside, right? That in a way that Mexico has this very interesting tradition of seeing itself from the outside and celebrating, valuing those representations that see Mexico from the outside perspective. Going back to D.H. Lawrence and the plumed serpent and so forth and to the present, it's a kind of, as negligible as those representations sometimes are, right? I think that it speaks about a very open and generous sense of what constitutes a so-called national culture.
Thank you.
If there are no more questions, thank you so much.